The Indian government forged a democratic constitution in 1950. It forged an independent foreign policy. And when the elections, first elections were held in January 1952, the communists had come over ground and contested the elections. And on the right, the right-wing Hindus had also formed their own political party, the Jansangh, which is a precursor to today's BJP, and at least abandoned the rhetoric of violence and extremism. So India today faces a similar kind of situation. In 2010, as in 1949 and 1950, the democratic center is threatened by forces, extremist forces of left and right. But there is one significant difference. The center in 1948, 49, 50 held. Will it hold now? The center today is corrupt and corroded. There are no modern equivalents of Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhai Patel, B.R. Ambedkar, who was the great untouchable leader who framed the Indian constitution, another very important figure in the making of democratic and independent India. There are no comparable uniters and nation builders in the democratic center. On the other hand, the center is corrupt and corroded. And the most striking manifestation of the corrosion of the democratic center, the weakness, the vulnerability, the lack of will of the democratic center is the conversion of political parties into family firms. This is true, of course, most obviously of the Indian National Congress, which has a great history, a party that is going to celebrate its 125th anniversary this year, one of the great political parties of the modern world, which created this new template of nationalism that I talked about, that brought into being democratic republican India, that inspired other political parties of great influence, such as the African National Congress, which took its name and its ideology and its whole idea of a rainbow coalition from the Indian National Congress. The Indian National Congress today, a once great party, is a family firm. The leadership passes from father to widow to son, and that's true also of other levels in the in the political party. I was at another university in Canada, which recently had visits from three ministers of the Congress Party, who were all sons of previous ministers. Now, so the kind of influence of family and kinship is much wider than that of the Nehru Gandhis. It also permeates other parties. In the Punjab, the Akali Dal, which had a fairly honorable history, which Professor Harjot Oberoi knows much better than me, but which arose in the 1920s as a progressive democratic movement against a corrupt Sikh clergy. That's been converted into the property of one family, the Badals. Go to the south of India, in the state of Tamil Nadu, the DMK, which again had a fairly honorable lineage, which, for example, had extremely progressive ideas on gender equality. That too is now the captive of a single party. And this is, I think, it's a challenge. I wouldn't call it a threat, but it's certainly a challenge, because political parties are open secular institutions. They should be open to anyone to enter, anyone to rise to the top. And if the major political party in India has set this pernicious example, which has been eagerly followed by many other parties, I think it doesn't really bode well for the health of Indian democracy. Along with the decline of the political party is the decline of public institutions in general. The civil services, the police, the judiciary, the universities. In my lifetime, I have seen these institutions decline in efficiency and capability, largely because of two or three things. Firstly, the increasing influence of kin and nepotism and caste and community on recruitment, on promotion, and on political interference. In Nehru's time, the civil service was autonomous from political interference. So you had independent, efficient political civil service, which would choose and allocate responsibilities from within. From the 1970s, politicians decided that they must have civil servants and departmental secretaries who were personally loyal to them. And that is kind of continued. And this loyalty could be because you've worked with someone for a long time, it could be because you speak the same language, because you come from the same kin group, and so on and so forth. There's also, of course, as you know, a great deal of straightforward corruption in the public sector. Now, the decline of the political party, the decline of public institutions, is partly responsible for one of the problems you mentioned, sir, the growing gap between the rich and the poor. The most spectacular manifestation of this growing gap between the rich and the poor in modern India is a house that is coming up on Altamount Road in Mumbai. It's a house that is being built for a single nuclear family the size of mine. Husband, wife, son, daughter, that's the size of my family. I live in a very nice house in Bangalore. It's about 2,500 square feet. It has space for my study. Each of my children has a room. It's rather privileged by Indian standards. However, this other nuclear family in Mumbai is building a house for its four members, which is 27 stories high and 400,000 square feet in extent. I think it's got four floors of parking, three floors of private cinema viewing, maybe two floors of swimming pools, I don't know what else, and maybe 500 rooms for servants, I'm not sure, but this is the most spectacular manifestation, but it's not the only manifestation. I mean, there's a kind of, a society in which between one third and one fourth of the population lives below the poverty line, and yet has some of the richest people in the world. There's something wrong. I mean, there's something that's not completely okay. I mean, I'm not a socialist. I don't believe in radical equality of result. I believe, however, that the state must do what it can to create at least equality of opportunity, to make sure that people, regardless of the home in which they're born, that they have the same life chances, they can go to decent schools, decent hospitals, have access to decent healthcare, have dignified employment. And I also believe in some kind of in a society in which, as Gandhi famously said, the capitalist acts as a trustee. Now, there's some exceptions. In my hometown, Bangalore, fortunately, the prosperous and successful industrialists are not as extraordinarily vulgar as this. I'll give you an illustration about this. I'll carry on with this example, if I may. And I don't want to single out this. Or maybe I do want to single out this Mumbai industrialist. But let me, by way of illustration, let me tell you my experience about this. There was a group from the Brookings Institution visiting India. And I spoke to them, like I'm speaking to you, and I mentioned this place. And afterwards, one of the members, whose name I forget, was appalled by this. He said, I didn't know this. And he said, he was a Dutchman. He was the former chairman and CEO of Unilever, one of the world's great companies. So a man of some considerable wealth himself. And he said, you know, this person who's building this house, this 27-story house, in a city in which 40% of the population live in slums, 60% do not have access to clean water and to healthcare and so on. He said, this guy is telling the rest of Bombay, up yours. Now, this is what this Dutchman, former head of Unilever, you know, not a Dutch socialist, you know, not an extremist Marxist, told me. And I was relating this to a friend who works in the Indian private sector. And I said, you know, this is what this person said. He said, oh, he's a Calvinist. You know, he'll think like this. If this Mumbai industrialist has made his money, why can't he spend it? So the Dutchman's alarm was treated with contempt. So there's a kind of brashness and vulgarity among the Indian middle class, which is very widespread. It is not one family, one individualist, one industrialist, and so on. And there's this stark poverty on the other hand. So that's challenge number five that the Republic of India faces. Challenge number six is the rapid pace of environmental degradation. And I'm not talking climate change here. I mean, what India's position should be in global climate change negotiations. Is it a spoiler or is it a crusader for justice? You know, I'm not going to debate that. But I'm going to talk about the condition of the domestic environment in India.